7:55 Express for Bradley will be leaving in 5 minutes from platform 3.
Pardon me, I think there is room for one more in here, is there not?
No, there's room for 5 more in this cabin.
Oh, forgive me. I am a harmless old myopic, and also I believe I am earlier than intended. No doubt more will arrive as the train fills.
Then perhaps you should sit down while there are still seats available.
Thank you so much. Oh, my bag.
Drat. Here, I'll help you with it.
So foolish of me.
Oh, I see from the name tag your name is Schreck. That's German for fright, I believe.
Almost. My name literally means Dr. Terror. Just ignore that, though. It's a meaningless detail.
These fell out, too. Oh, they're tarot cards. I recognize the style of artwork.
Oh, you know much about art.
I certainly do. And I also know what I don't like. Superstitious rot rendered in garishly crude imagery.
The tarot deck, which I nickname my House of Horrors because I am charming, holds the knowledge of the future, Mr. Marsh.
Well, it's no surprise you know my name. I'm well known to my art criticism. And I find these cards' depictions of death as a scythe-wielding skeleton childishly obvious.
Your knowledge of the tarot deck seems particularly outdated. The deck I carry is a modern version. If you look closely at the cards, you will see they depict figures which function in a modern context, essential for making sense of our current times as well as to predict the future.
Let me see. A television DJ, a tap dancer standing on the Guinness Book of Records. What's this one of a harlequin standing underneath this emblem of a bird and an arrow?
That denotes an actor out of the Hunger Games.
Oh, and I think that's supposed to be Sean Connery.
Yes, I like that one.
Well, I must confess I'm something of a fan of Mr. Connery, too. Do you seriously expect me to believe that these cards constitute a prediction of the future? DJs, tap dancers, the star of some dystopic cinematic blockbuster, and the man who plays James Bond.
These men will join us in this cabin, and using the tarot, I will be able to tell each one a story of his future. It is ordained. The tarot deck predicts the truth, the supernatural truth, always.
What utter balderdash.
Can we help you, Inspector?
Sorry to interrupt, gentlemen, but it looks like there are 3 seats in this cabin, and I've got Top of the Pops Alan Fluff Freeman, Roy Castle OBE, and Donald Sutherland desperate to sit down.
Excuse me. Sorry.
Now that they're here, Mr. Marsh, I'll have to explain the whole tarot single game so I can get on with telling their fortunes. I enjoy this bit, so please don't steal my thunder. Gentlemen, perhaps you have heard of the tarot?
Hold on a minute. What about Connery? The bunch of jets, I've got another one for you. None other than the famous Scottish film star, Neil McCallum.
Just sit down here. Oh, Kevin, I just come past it here. Oh, thank you very much.
Who the bloody hell is Neil McCallum?
I never said I was perfect.
Films I've seen. It's not Hammer.
Welcome to the second episode of the Lee Cushing Podcast. I am not Lee Cushing.
And neither am I. I'm actually Dan.
And I'm actually Howard. And this is the podcast which will celebrate and analyse each of the 24 films, mostly in the horror genre, to feature the legendary teaming of the great and much missed actors, Peter Cushing OBE and Sir Christopher Lee. As well as this, each episode of the podcast will feature additional items allowing us to express a wider appreciation of the history and legacy of British horror cinema. And why is that, Dan?
Because we love it.
We do. We love it indeed. And I believe today we're going to be talking about a particular favourite film of mine, an absolute classic of the genre, Dr. Terror's House of Horrors.
Dr. Terror's House of Horrors, we certainly are. It's a favourite of mine, and it was actually probably the first horror film, not the first horror film I ever saw, but certainly the first kind of horror film of this period that I ever saw. I kind of knew what Amicus was as a production company, because when I was 12 or so, or 11, I saw the Doctor Who films starring Peter Cushing from the early 60s, and they were made by the same company as this, but just afterwards. And I'd read a bit about those, so I kind of knew the name Amicus. But the listener may not, so can you explain something about who Amicus were?
Well, Amicus was a company set up by a brilliant man, I believe he's brilliant, called Milton Subotsky, who was American.
He was, and in fact we talked about it in the first episode of this podcast, because he was the guy who originally went to Hammer with the idea of remaking Frankenstein, but he didn't have anything to do with their actual production.
Yeah, anyway, he set up, in the early 60s, well, he set up a production company called Amicus Films. And as a sort of rival to Hammer, in a way, but doing something different, or trying to do something different. And one of the things he wanted to do, he was a big fan, as indeed a lot of people are, of a brilliant Ealing film called Dead of Night, which is one, which is an anthology film. It's four or five stories in one with a sort of like connecting story. And it's the one with Michael Redgrave and the ventriloquist dummy.
Yes.
That's the absolute classic, famous sequence, famous story from it.
And it's the only horror film made by Ealing Studios, who were most famous for their comedies.
It's one of the very few horror films made in Britain at that time, in the 1940s. So it's brilliant. It's a wonderful film. If you get a chance to see that, certainly see it. It's got an all-star cast, Mervyn Johns and Googie Withers and Basil Radford and Norton Wayne. Anyway, Milton Subotsky saw this film and he thought, that's an idea. Let's have, instead of having just one vampire or one werewolf or one monster, let's have four or five in the same film. And it's an idea that certainly was very successful, this film, when it came out, I believe.
Well, I think another thing which probably occurred to him was that the anthology movie as a genre was much more common then than now. There was, you know, you would have anthology dramas. Mm. There's a film called Train of Events, which is,
well, there was some Somerset Maugham films, weren't there, sort of in the 50s, late 40s, 50s. Three Somerset Maugham stories in one. So, yes, yeah, so the idea of the anthology film, the portmanteau film, was quite well established then. And Roger Corman had done some in America as well, in Tales of Terror with Vincent Price.
Was that before this?
I think it was before this.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
It's when he was doing all his Poe films.
Right.
So it wasn't a new idea, but it was sort of like a new idea for the horror film in Britain. And it's very, one of the many things I love about Dr. Terror's House of Horrors is the title. Dr. Terror's House of Horrors. It's the most unambiguous, brilliantly lurid title you could possibly have. There's no, you know, it's unapologetically a horror film. This is a film, Milton Subotsky says, right, I'm going to make the ultimate film for horror film fans. It's going to have a werewolf, it's going to have a vampire, it's going to have a crawling hand, it's going to have man-eating plants, it's going to have Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee and Michael Gough. It's going to be directed by Freddie Francis. We're going to have all the, and it's just, that's what I love about it. They're so sort of like, they've got the courage of their convictions. It's so unpretentious, a piece of entertainment, and it it works.
And as well as poaching Hammer's headlining stars, and as you say, and plus Michael Gough, who'd also done some Hammer stuff and was known for horror, Subotsky assembled a weird kind of all-star cast to surround them.
Well, he'd made some musicals, you see, and I think just as a kind of insurance, he thought, well, I'll have a couple of sort of like light entertainment or musical personalities in the film, just to sort of appeal to that audience. So he's got Roy Castle, who's great, you know, we all know Roy Castle. And he's got Alan Fluff Freeman.
And Kenny Lynch.
And Kenny Lynch, yes. Alan Fluff Freeman is just, he just has this bemused expression. He obviously doesn't know why he's there, you know, because he's not an actor. He's sort of like a DJ, and he's sort of...
Well, he was the Top of the Pops presenter.
Yes, he was a big name at that time, and he was, and it's fascinating. It's what makes the film so charming, is that they have those sort of people in it. And like Roy Castle, everybody loves Roy Castle, so, you know, sort of... It is such an eclectic cast. You've got a young Donald Sutherland before he was famous. And you've got Bernard Lee from the James Bond films and all that. In the later films, they had more international stars.
Yeah.
They had people like Terry Thomas and Ralph Richardson and Kurt Jurgens and John Collins and Charlotte Rampling and Richard Todd, lots of people. This is more sort of character actors around at the time, the kind of people who would be in the Avengers or who'd be in Hammer films.
Yeah, Jeremy Kemp from Zed Cars.
Yes, Jeremy Kemp and Anne Bell and Jennifer Jane, who'd been in a couple of, I think, science fiction films by that stage.
Okay, yeah, and we'll talk more about her later.
And Neil McCallum, who needs no introduction, he's very famous.
Very famous Scottish actor.
Yeah. So it's a fascinating cast, And it's a fascinating film. And I suppose with all sort of like portmanteau films, you have to take them one story at a time.
And obviously the stories vary in quality, but we'll talk about the overall effect of the whole movie as well as the individual stories, but also the linking story and how these all combine together to have the overall effect on you, of how you feel when you walk out of the cinema, essentially. The structure of these films is that there tends to be, it's not always the case, but certainly in all the Amicus films and in Dead of Night and some of the others, there's not just four or five stories, there's also a linking narrative which comes in between the stories. And the linking narrative in Dr. Terror's House of Horrors is set on a train, in a train cabin, as we've alluded to in our spoofy opening, where Peter Cushing's Dr. Shrek treats his fellow passengers to a reading of their futures via tarot cards, and each reading results in a story. So we've got these five characters, and each of them stars in an individual story. And the first person to pluck up the courage to tap his hands on the cards and have his future read is Neil McCallum, who plays an architect. And in the story that unfolds, he is going out to a remote island in the Hebrides where his family home is, but he doesn't live there anymore. The lady who owns it now wants to renovate the building, and because he's an architect and he knows it so well, she's employing him to survey it, essentially. And there's obviously something mysterious and scary going on. I mean, what we should say is, spoilers.
Well, that's especially with these sort of films, because they're only 20 minutes, and each story invariably has a twist at the end, which we can't give away.
Yeah.
So it's quite difficult to sort of discuss them without.
I think, as the listener might have gathered by now, I mean, these are old films, and a lot of the audiences might have been expected to have watched them before listening to this. Of course, we hope that some of you may just be curious about the films and listen to this and decide whether. So we don't want to spoil particular details, but we will, you know, we'll have to say certain things to discuss a certain amount of what's going on. And I think it's okay to say, well, for heaven's sake, it's the title of the episode is Werewolf.
Must be the coffin of Cosmo Valdemar.
The werewolf. Over 200 years ago, Cosmo Valdemar claimed that this house was really his, and that my ancestors had stolen it from him. But he vowed that one day he'd return.
He swore that his place would be taken by whoever owned the house, and that he himself would once again assume human shape. His grave was never found.
Yeah, there is a werewolf.
So there's a werewolf.
We can't say who the werewolf is. Yeah, that's the thing about the film. It's not only called Dr. Terror's House of Horrors, but each of the episodes is just named after the monster that's in it.
Yes.
So it's called Werewolf, Crawling Hand, Creeping Vine. You know, there's no attempt to be subtle or to be sort of abstract or anything. It's just, that's what it's about. It's about a werewolf. So yeah, call it werewolf.
So basically, if you don't want to be spoiled, but you've looked at the credits, you're buggered, essentially. Yeah, and speaking of spoilers, those who've seen the trailer pretty much will know whatever the hell's in the film. It gives a lot of it away. But also, I love the brass neck of Subotsky. The tagline in the trailer is, horrors never before depicted on screen. What horrors have we got here? A werewolf, a vampire, a disembodied creeping hand, which had been done at least once and would be done several more times. Voodoo, which has been in cinema since the 30s. And what are we missing? Oh, and a creeping vine, which was like the newest thing, but there'd already been a film of Day of the Triffids.
Yes, but it's never all been done in the same film.
No, and that does add up to fun.
Yes.
Yeah, I do think the first segment, the Neil McCallum segment, is a bit of a strange one. I can't really work out the plot, even though I've seen it loads of
times. It is weird. It took me a while to realise that it's his house. He's going back to his house, and Ursula Howells is living there. That was a bit complicated. I didn't quite. But it's a good one to start with, because it's a well-made story, and it has got a classic monster. It has got a werewolf in it. Ursula Howells, who was one of Freddie Francis' favourite actresses, she's in quite a few of it. She's in Torture Garden, which is the next anthology film they made after this one, and some of his TV stuff is very good.
Yeah, she's actually remarkably good. I mean, from this film, I got the impression she was a big star. She probably should have been.
She should have been a big star. Again, I think she's one of those actresses who preferred to be on stage. She was a theatre actress who just occasionally did TV and films to sort of, you know.
She puts real meaning into everything.
She's brilliant.
She has an extremely distinct type of beauty.
Yeah, she's very glamorous, very stylish.
The doctors decided that I needed complete rest and quiet. So I came here.
And now, you've decided you want to rejoin the human race, eh?
Why'd you say that?
Well, you're having this room made into a ballroom.
Oh, that's not for entertaining. You see, my husband was an archaeologist. He had a large collection of very valuable specimens from all over the world. I intend to turn this into a sort of museum to his memory. It's a beautiful house. And you're welcome to visitors anytime.
I just think it's a nice, creepy, atmospheric story to start with. And it's not too demanding. It's not too, you know, sort of weird. It's just, it's sort of like, lets you into the film quite well. It's I think it's just a good story to begin with.
However, then we've got Creeping Vine.
Yes.
Which is the story, the segment starring the DJ.
Alan Fluff Freeman.
And what I need to do is, to preface this, is I have a friend who I know is rather fond of this film, and I also knew that we were doing this podcast, so I just cornered him and asked him about it without warning on recording it, but without telling him what I was going to ask. And I'd just like to play you what he said.
Here we are at the Royal Exchange Theatre, just before the press night of Wit, and I'm just taking you to one side for 5 minutes to ask you for your opinions on a movie that you've seen called Dr. Terror's House of Horrors. What is your first thought when I mention to you Dr. Terror's House of Horrors?
It isn't any fun without Rusty.
That's the line I used to. That's the line I used to say with my nephew. My nephew Elliot, but that was our catchphrase. It isn't any fun without Rusty. Yeah, that was
the little girl who says that is so RP.
Who is that talking man?
That's my friend Ben.
Right. And somebody else has picked up, but that's my catchphrase.
And he's got something to say about the other stories as well. But
that actress, by the way, grew up to be, her name is now Phoebe Nichols.
She's a very
distinguished actress who appears in Foyle's War and Midsummer Murders and all those sort of things and various films.
I cannot believe that's Phoebe Nichols.
Yes. Sarah Nichols became Phoebe Nichols.
That is just extraordinary. Yes. I was just watching Phoebe Nichols last night in The Road to Coronation Street, which was showing as a tribute to the late, great Tony Warren, creator of Coronation Street. And I just commented to my mum, who I was watching it with, she's an actress who doesn't turn up enough, but whenever she does turn up in something, I go, my God, that's Phoebe Nichols, and she's great.
Yeah, she's in a lot of stuff. She's very good. But anyway, that's how she started. She was about 10 years old, I imagine, when that film was made. So anyway, she was called Sarah Nichols. And it's actually got a very good cast. Bernard Lee's in it, and Anne Bell's in it, and Jeremy Kemp.
I want to say a few things about this segment. By the way, dear listener, that line that we've quoted 20 times already is said by a little girl who's... the story is that... Alan Freeman moves into a new house with his family, and for some reason the garden is full of sentient plants which start to attack the house, and they kill the dog Rusty and traumatise the child, hence the line.
Darling, it's a lovely day, why don't you go out and play?
It isn't any fun without Rusty.
Unfortunately, this segment, although it does have a great cast, is like... And the wonder of it, the joy of it probably, is that it is a jaw-dropping example of everything you shouldn't do in a movie.
It's very bad.
It's terrible.
It really is.
I mean, for start with, right, the main character isn't the main character. Probably because it's Alan Freeman and he can't act. He doesn't have anything to do with anything that happens in the story. It's his house and his family, but he just stands in the background. His wife and daughter suffer all the actual plant attacks. And then they bring in a couple of guys to help and to investigate what's going on. And again, he just stands in the background while in the front foreground, Bernard Lee and Jeremy Kemp talk to each other about what might be happening. And he literally does nothing. It's so bizarre. Then you've got things like Phoebe Nichols played a little girl, but I'm not convinced that she didn't also play the dog, because when Rusty runs around and gets attacked by the plant, it's going, rah, 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 literally doing that. It's a human voice. It's not a dog barking.
Probably Percy Edwards. No, Percy Edwards?
No.
Oh, he did. He was an animal impressionist. When I was growing up, he was on telly all the time on Blue Peter. He could impersonate all sorts of animals. There's all sorts of films where he does the voices of various birds and things.
Good. I think he might be a little bit good for it then.
Well,
I think he might be a bit good if that's the case. None of it makes any sense.
No, it's all a bit shonky. There's never an explanation about why the plants have suddenly become sentient and become sort of homicidal.
And there's
Alan Freeman just comes back from his holidays and... it happens, and he sort of tries to cut one with a pair of shears, and it knocks the shears out of his hands.
But then later they're able to cut cuttings for analysis.
Yes.
And there's no problem with doing that.
What if a plant were to take the next step? And what if there were a mutation that could develop intelligence, the ability to protect itself? Perhaps even to know who its enemies were and destroy them. A plant like that could take over the world.
The lead performance in it really is Bernard Lee, who plays like the guy from the Ministry of Psychotic Plants or something, who is kind of takes charge of the situation, and he has a couple of terrible speeches which he really knocks out of the park.
Yes.
In just this really impressive authoritative way, where you think this is why he was so good and so commanding as James Bond's boss in the first sort of 11 James Bond films and stuff.
It could be the end of the world. Open the door.
Yeah, he's too good for it, but he's kind of like, he's got that sort of, it's that demeanor of like, I've signed on the dotted line, so I'm going to play the part as well as I possibly can. It's ridiculous, the lines are ridiculous, but let's just do it. I'm a professional, so let's go.
No, he's completely credible.
And that's exactly how you should play it.
Yeah.
The worst kind of acting for a horror film is to ham it up or sort of, or be very self-conscious or sort of like wink to the audience, whatever. You have to play these things straight, which is what Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee always did. They always played it straight. It was never tongue-in-cheek. They always took it seriously. And that's why the films are so good. It's because they play it in the way it should be played. But as for this particular story, yes, it's a bit shonky. That's the problem with an anthology film, is that inevitably some of the stories are going to be good and some of the stories are going to be bad. And so it's quite difficult to assess whether a film is good or not if half of it is good and half of it is. I said there were more good stories in this film than bad stories. This is the only really story that doesn't work.
Yes, yeah, we'll come to that.
It's also all filmed on, it's quite obviously all filmed on a set, and it's not, there's no location work or anything for
this particular story.
For this particular story.
I mean, it's strange because sometimes, as in a lot of Hammer films, and in fact, as in the first segment in this film, which is also clearly all filmed on sets indoors, exterior locations recreated in studios have an atmosphere to them and a kind of artifice that kind of helps the mood in these kind of fantastic films, and is, you know, I think kind of helps the mood in TV series that use them a lot, like The Avengers. It doesn't work in The Creeping Vine.
It works in the first one.
Yeah.
Because it's there to create atmosphere.
But in the second one, you've just got this kind of astroturf garden, and everything looks kind of bright, and yeah, it's just awful, really. But I still love it. But the reason I love it is because I love it because it's in a film that's otherwise rather dear to me, and also it's just hilariously inept, I think.
Yes.
But before we go on to the next story, let's just mention Peter Cushing a little bit. We'll get to talk about Christopher Lee later. These guys are the focus of this podcast, after all. Christopher Lee has one of the latest stories to himself, but also we've got Peter Cushing is throughout this film in the linking sequences. And actually, his entrance is one of my favourite moments in any film.
Yes, he sort of wipes the condensation from the window or something, doesn't he, and looks inside the...
Looks inside the cabin and then leans in, yeah. Accompanied by a gorgeously mysterious, slightly wry piece of woodwind music by Elisabeth Lutyens.
Pardon me, I think there is room for one more in here, is there not?
Yes, right here.
Oh, right. Cushing's performance in this is kind of funny.
Yes.
But it's almost winking at the camera. There are a couple of moments where he looks directly into the camera, but he doesn't do anything that undermines the drama. He just kind of lets you in on the joke a little bit. And the fact of all the Amicus films, which is, this is fun and entertainment. In fact, the Amicus movies, they made me into a horror fan because they made me realise that horror could be fun.
Mm.
And with all of them, you are chuckling a bit at the ambition, the silliness, the fact that they've got so much in one movie, and the kind of po-faced way that quite outrageous and sometimes hackneyed things are presented. And there's a wonderful moment in the first scene when Dr. Terror is introducing himself to everyone else, and he says that the cards are the key, and Alan Freeman says, "The key to what?" And he has his little speech where he goes, "The strange, the weird, the terrifying." And he actually looks in the camera when he says, "The terrifying, the mysterious, the unusual." You know, and there's just that little moment. But at the same time, he's completely different and almost unrecognisable Van Helsing.
It's quite an unusual part of him at that time, because at that time he was to be associated either with dashing heroes like Van Helsing or refined, ruthless villains like Frankenstein. And that's what he'd been playing up to then, certainly for Hammer, and in the other films he'd done. And here he is playing this sort of heavily made-up character.
He's got a lovely whiskery beard.
Middle European accent, being very mysterious and quite sinister and quite silky, smooth. And it's quite a departure for him. And he clearly is enjoying it.
Mm.
You know, but he plays it straight. It's not a tongue-in-cheek performance. It's not a sort of, this is beneath me, but I'm doing it kind of.
No, there's love in it, yeah. I think. So coming out of the Creeping Vine story, not to give away the ending, but Alan Freeman looks at Dr. Terror and says,
"And that's going to happen to me."
And then Dr. Terror goes, "Will anybody else want the tabs of cards?" And we go on to the next character, who is Biff Bailey, played by Roy Castle. Tell us a little about that story, Howard.
Roy Castle, in a part that was intended for Akabilk.
Oh, right.
But he was ill, so he couldn't do it. So Roy Castle took over. And Roy Castle was a great musician, of course, so he could play the trumpet and everything. Plays a musician called Biff Bailey, who was sent by his agent off to the West Indies for a gig or something. An island with lots of voodoo going on. And he listens to a voodoo ceremony and really likes the music. And he thinks this voodoo music could be a hit record back in Britain. So he writes it down. But he's seen writing it down, so the high priest of the voodoo cult puts a curse on him. And he falls into some water, which is what happens.
It's as thrilling as it sounds.
Yeah,
no,
Tubby Hayes Quartet are with him as well, and Kenny Lynch. So it's it's a curious one, this, because it's a lighter, it's like the comedy one,
yeah,
in a sense, because you've got Roy Castle in it, and there's a bit of slapstick. Like I say, he does fall into some water, and he's sort of like, there's jokes in it and everything. But I think it's the scariest.
Okay. All right.
He said controversially.
I'll say some stuff, and then you can come to explain why you think it's the scariest. Well, I also asked my friend Ben about this, because I remembered that he'd commented on it when he first discovered Dr. Terror's House of Horrors, and this is what he said.
Pure racism, but, you know, it's got Roy Castle in as well, so it's of its time. To be fair, it is a bit racist, and I can't say any more than that. However, it's got Roy Castle in, and it is of its time.
You've already said that it's a bit racist, but do you maybe want to expand on that or say anything else about that particular story?
It's a lot racist. They call it the West Indies, and they don't make it very specific, and they don't really go into details. It does kind of look like somebody's gone, oh, well, you know, voodoo's this, and this is the West Indies, and we'll put all the stereotypes in there. Kind of doubt it was written by somebody that's actually been out there and experienced kind of like the idea and the approach to voodoo behind the time. I think it's just someone's idea that they've put in there, and I think it probably does reflect the 60s attitude of different cultures and different ethnicities within that time, and how people were very blinkered to that. And I just, it was the story that kind of disappointed me a bit, because I think it was just, yeah, I think at the time it's quite culturally ignorant.
Okay.
I just didn't like that story out of them all. I thought there were better ones in there, and that was the one for me that I didn't kind of love so much. I mean, and I was kind of laughing at it so much because of the cultural ignorance that was in there.
I think it's just worth asking the question, do we think this is racist?
I would say it isn't.
You wrote down the sacred music of the great god Dambella.
What we've got is, obviously they don't go on location. We have a recreation of an island in Shepperton Studios, and a couple of scenes of supposed local tribal voodoo practice, and London actors, all genuinely black actors playing these characters. But what I would say is, you know, in those days, this kind of stuff happened all the time. If it is racist, it's no more racist than any other movie of the time. It's no more racist than James Bond's Dr. No, for instance. I'm sure it's not a very accurate representation of any kind of voodoo religion, but it wouldn't be the only horror movie to mess with that either.
I suppose, looked at now objectively, yes, it is. I suppose it does make you a bit uncomfortable, the portrayal of the people on the island. But I don't think it's intended to be. Like you say, it's no more racist than anything else at the time. I don't think it was. If you're doing a story about voodoo, it has to be like this in a way.
Well, what I'd also add is that, as you said before, it is the comedy segment. And the mark of a good comedy segment is it's funny. And the mark of any portrayal of any story, really, when you're dealing with whether it's racist or not, is how sophisticated is it? And actually, it is quite sophisticated. In fact, what I would say is the reason the Creeping Vine story is in this movie is to make you realise how good the following story is. Because after you've just watched The Creeping Vine, which makes you want to kill yourself, this one is incredibly good. The music's great. It has genuine ethnic minority performers like Kenny Lynch, who plays a character not unlike himself, and writes and performs a couple of the songs, and they're great. Take me in your arms and then kiss me. No more false eyes, baby.
Give me love. You still going through that voodoo thing, man?
Sure, why not?
I'll tell you one thing. You got guts.
Thanks.
We'll probably see him before the night's out. Spread all over the floor. They'll eat anything here.
There's loads of great jokes. The dialogue's really fast and funny.
Yeah, there's some great jokes in it. But also, yeah, it is a comedy episode, but there's also what I think is the scariest sequence in the film, which is where Roy Castle leaves the club and walks back to his house. And it's really, really brilliantly done. It's so eerie. And it's so scary. And so a car suddenly pulls up and he sort of like jumps. And it makes the audience jump as well, because it's a shock moment. And there's all like wind blowing and he's stumbling around. And it's a really eerie, scary, effective sequence. And even when he's playing the music in the club and there's this sort of like supernatural wind that comes in and starts blowing things about and everything gets knocked around and everything. But he keeps on playing. Because, you know, people are paid to see him, so it's really well done. It's like, that's not done in any kind of comedic way.
No.
That's done absolutely, the horror element of that story is done absolutely straight.
Yeah.
And it is scary. And
because the humour is funny, it actually helps the horror. It's how good horror comedy should work. The scary bits are scary, the funny bits are funny, and they reinforce each other because the contrast makes you notice. When it's suddenly not funny anymore and you realise you're scared, that's what's wonderful about this kind of movie and the great horror comedy movies, of which there aren't very many, like Scream and An American Werewolf in London and stuff like that. They all do that.
There's also a brilliant moment where Roy Castle sort of falls to the ground and behind him there's a poster for a film called Dr. Terror's House of Horrors, starring Biff Bailey. And the names of the characters, the actors in the film on this poster are the names of the characters in the film, if you see what I mean. And that's an amazingly kind of self-referential, or whatever the word is, sort of thing, that there's a poster for the film in the film.
It is, again, it reminds you of Scream.
And it's a really, yeah, it's a really clever touch. And Roy Castle, of course, is lovable. Everybody loves Roy Castle, and he's brilliant, and he's...
Yeah, and he's a perfect kind of protagonist for this kind of story, which is that you think he's an idiot for doing what he's doing, but he's likeable enough that you go with it anyway, and you don't want him to come a cropper.
No, you don't, yeah, because Roy Castle, you don't want anything to happen to him, so... So yeah, I think that I know people have accused it of being racist. I wouldn't want to say that it isn't, but I just think and it's of its time, which can be a bit of a cop out.
I think it's well intended.
Yes, it is. I don't think it's intended to be offensive to anybody.
If there's an accusation of racism, it's that the voodoo culture depicted in the film is not accurate, and also the characters don't seem very sophisticated. But I think they're straightforward, menacing archetypes, aren't they? But that's what makes it funny. Biff Bailey's such an idiot. And the kind of voodoo characters don't do anything evil. He's the bad guy. He steals something from them which he shouldn't. And they just come after him. And the way that they come after him is scary. But also there's a kind of black comedy to some things that happen as part of that part of the story as well.
It's film voodoo, isn't it? It's voodoo as in portrayed in so many films.
So that's a much better segment of the film, and the following segment is arguably even better than that one. The following segment is Disembodied Hand.
Yes.
Now, this bit of the movie is kind of generally regarded as the strongest segment.
I think so, yes.
By a number of critics. And also, it's if you fancy checking out a bit of this movie, you can see it for free and legally, because Screenbound Pictures, who I think distribute the DVD of the movie at the moment, have put this whole segment on YouTube as a kind of advert for the movie. I think perhaps they shouldn't have put the best bit of the movie on YouTube, but it's there if you want to check it out. It's also quite regularly broadcast, by the way, on our beloved horror channel.
Yes, I think it's coming up soon. So
it seems to be on every month or so, so watch out for that. But yeah, in Disembodied Hand, we have an art critic, Franklin Marsh, played by Christopher Lee, and we have an artist, played by Michael Gough. I can't remember the name of the artist.
Eric Landor,
of course.
Christopher Lee's playing a very unsympathetic character here. He's a very egotistical and rather arrogant art critic. And he's sort of like, he's constantly criticising the Michael Gough character. So Michael Gough decides he's going to get his revenge. I won't give away how he does that. Christopher Lee's character is humiliated. So in order to get his revenge on Michael Gough, he runs him over And somehow, Michael Gough's hand gets cut off during this hit-and-run incident.
Yeah, very neatly.
Very neatly, yeah. I'm not quite sure that would happen. And then Michael Gough, who was an artist, but he can't paint anymore because he's got no hand, so he commits suicide with his other hand. Then the disembodied hand sort of returns from the grave and attacks Christopher Lee. This is much more like, I think, the stories in the later anthology films, because Christopher Lee character is somebody who is unsympathetic, so there's the idea of getting his comeuppance. He's being punished for being arrogant and pompous and driving this man and trying to kill this man.
A lot of these stories have a kind of Twilight Zone or Outer Limits.
It's not very nice people.
With a moral dimension.
Yeah, there's a moral element to a lot of the later ones, but not in this one. In all the other ones, they're just sort of like fairly
stories.
Innocent people, nice people who get caught up in these sort of terrible events. Whereas sort of Christopher Lee's asking for it, in a sense. He's not a nice person. And he does get his comeuppance, and he is. And it's great because it's sort of like, I mean, the hand itself is not the most convincing prop, but...
I think he's pretty good, actually.
I think it's pretty good for his time. Hmm. But what sells it is Christopher Lee's sort of like reactions to it, because he's very good at being terrified.
He's
looking
fantastic.
Terrified. And when there's one scene where it attacks him by the fire and hits it with a poker, he looks absolutely bloody... It does look terrified. He looks sort of like...
And there's a bit. He manages to pick the hand up and put it into the fire, and you see it writhing in the flames. And he looks so vividly disgusted by that. It's a great performance from him, and you're engrossed in his emotions throughout it, really.
Yes, and even in the sort of like the connecting story, he's sort of like the bad guy. He's the one who's constantly attacking.
He's belittling Dr. Shrek,
belittling him.
Yeah.
Really, do we have to suffer all this nonsense?
There's no harm in it.
Astrologers, spiritualists, table rappers, the entire lunatic fringe. They've been exposed for the charlatans they are over and over again.
Perhaps you would like to learn your future. Just taps a call.
I must warn you, gentlemen, this is undoubtedly a well-rehearsed prelude to some shabby form of confidence trick. You can fool all these others as much as you please, Doctor, but kindly leave me out of it.
The table rappers and the whole lunatic fringe and all this sort of thing, and he's putting him down. All the others are sort of like, well, I'm quite interested in what you're saying. And Christopher Lee said, no, this is all nonsense, forget about it. I'm Franklin Marsh, I'm very important, I'm very famous. So he's sort of like the closest thing to a kind of a villain in the film. Whereas the others are sort of just people just get caught up in these bizarre situations and don't really deserve some of the things they get. Whereas he sort of does in the later films, in sort of like Tales from the Crypt or Vault of Horror, most of them are unpleasant people who get their just desserts. Some terrible kind of punishment for the things they've done. But that was the kind of thing that developed later on, not particularly in this film.
And Michael Gough, who every time anyone talks about Michael Gough, because it's the most familiar thing, they always say he was Alfred in the Batman films, the Tim Burton and Joel Schumacher Batman films from the 80s and 90s, which was kind of right at the end of his career. He was also in a couple of later Tim Burton films, and I think his last one was Alice in Wonderland, where he did a voice. And then he died, and nobody knows quite how old.
No, he's very vague about it. He doesn't know whether he was born in 1915 or 1960s. He says he couldn't remember.
Right.
I think I'm going to adopt the same policy. I can't remember when I was born.
Well, he was an enigmatic guy with an interesting life and interesting experiments with kinds of drugs and things. He was a very 1960s guy, even though he was not of that generation. And he'd already had form in horror. He was in Hammer's Dracula with Cushing and Lee, and he was in Horrors of the Black Museum.
Horrors of the Black Museum. Yeah,
Gorgo,
he did a few, sort of like...
Conga. Sorry, he was in Conga.
He's in Horrors of the Black Museum, and he's in Conga. And he's in a film called Black Zoo, which I've never seen.
I've never seen any of them,
In Phantom of the Opera. Phantom of the Opera. Playing the villain in that.
And I think he's an actor who... I mean, I love him as well as Batman. He was in The Avengers a lot. He's in Doctor Who... You know, I always like to see him. He is a bit of a hammy guy sometimes. Sometimes he can't be bothered to try. There's an episode of Blake 7 he's in where he looks asleep. however, he is really good as this character. And the relationship between him and the critic, you feel the resentment on both sides very strongly. And then after the car accident where the artist has lost his hand, there's a wonderful scene, which is the worst production value in the film, where he's looking at the stump of his hand, and it's really terribly obvious that Michael Gough's fist has just been wrapped up in bandages, and Gough has to look at it with a sense of, oh no, I've lost my hand, how am I ever going to go on? And it's to Gough's immense credit that it is poignant, and you do feel
it
the
is
sadness.
Poignant. There's a scene where he's sort of like crying.
Yeah.
Is he looking at his pictures? He's done before this happened, and it's sort of it is very poignant. And you also get the sense that Franklin Marsh, the critic, has disparaged a lot of people over the years. So Michael Gough's revenge on him is kind of representing a lot of artists that have been sort of attacked by the critic. So it's sort of like that sense. It's not just a personal thing, perhaps, but it's sort of like this critic has just been knocking people and disparaging people and being derogatory for a long time, and somebody's finally putting him in his place, kind of thing.
Yeah, and the story works as a parable like that, and it works as just a really engaging tale because of that. It's well told and so well acted. And I know me and you have said before that we are actors and we bang on about actors and the quality of certain performances, but in a way, that moment where he's crying over his obviously not severed hand is kind of symbolic of what I love about a lot of these movies, that they still touch your heart and deliver something true and real, even if they're really cheap or whatever, you know, because the acting is so good and sometimes the writing is so good. Something else about this story that I just like, a random detail, is that when the credits come up at the end, it kind of gives you the titles of all the stories and the actors who are in them. It doesn't tell you the characters they played, and it doesn't tell you all the actors. So the credit for this particular story says, Disembodied Hand, Christopher Lee, Michael Gough. That's it. There's loads of other actors in this.
There's a lot of... There's a young Isla Blair. Yeah. There's a young Judy Cornwell, who was in Keeping Up Appearances. So, yeah, that's annoying.
But luckily, one of the books that we love and refer to, Jonathan Rigby's English Gothic, lists Dr. Terrors as one of the 100 most significant British horror films of the last century. And it does have a full cast list, including all the uncredited characters, so that's well worth investigating if you want to find out details like that. She was known as 12-tone Lizzie. Does this mean anything to you?
I don't know very much about Elisabeth Lutyens, no.
I think we should just talk about her. Elisabeth Lutyens, who was the daughter of a famous architect and born in 1906. So when this movie was made, she was like 59. She'd been composing for about 30 years. And in a way, she only kind of broke out into mainstream knowledge when she started writing music for horror films. Although, within academic circles and kind of more high-minded musical circles, she was known as one of the exponents of the 12-tone serialist style of musical composition developed by a man called Arnold Schoenberg. And right, I'm not a musical expert. I'm just learning the banjo now, and I'm not very good, but I'm trying to pick these things up. Do you know anything about serialism?
No.
12-tone composition?
No.
Well, I've just looked into it. You know when you've got a musical scale, there's 8 notes in it, plus the black notes on the keyboard. But it's really the 8 notes are the important ones. But Schoenbergian serialism, all 12 are equally important, and you create your melodies based on using all 12 notes. It's probably one of those things that is complicated to explain and actually affects the final product less than it sounds like it should. However, that was part of Elisabeth Lutyens' technique, and I think what's obvious and wonderful is how effective it is for this kind of movie and how unusual. There's very few other film scores like this that are kind of seductive and melancholic and gentle and chilling. I'm a huge fan of this score and of her other horror movie scores. It wasn't her first horror movie score, this. She'd spent like the 50s writing music for documentaries and TV shows, but in the 60s moved into horror and had done a Hammer film for Freddie Francis, which was Paranoiac. '63, one of Hammer's rare modern set black and white thrillers. And then she did The Earth Dies Screaming, which is a Terence Fisher movie for Planet Film Productions.
With Dennis Price.
Yeah, and that's a great little, very, very cheap, spooky sci-fi movie, which is so cheap that it uses stock footage from Village of the Damned, but it's still worth watching. And she did The Skull, for Freddie Francis, for Amicus, with Christopher Lee and Peter Cushing. We'll be talking about that in detail in another episode. And later on she did a couple more. She did The Terranaut.
The Terranaut. Have you seen The Terranaut?
I haven't seen
it. Oh, my God.
That's like one of Amicus's, in the style of their Doctor Who films, it's one of their kind of attempts to make kiddie sci-fi, isn't it?
Yes. The budget is not high for that film. I think that's the one with Charles Hawtrey in.
Right.
So you can imagine the kind of thing that it, and Patricia Hayes. I saw it a long time ago. It's No, it just makes me smile remembering it. I don't want to give too much away. Have
sure.
to watch it.
Well, I'll try to. Maybe it'll be on the Horror Channel soon. Let's hope so.
Have you got any thoughts about the vampire episode starring none other than Donald Sutherland?
Yeah, although the issue is every time I watch that, all I can think about is the plot for Don't Look Now. So I just describe it as Don't Look Now with vampires, which it totally isn't. But every time I see a horror film with Donald Sutherland, I do think of, you know, the classic Red Mac and a dwarf, not so much a vampire.
So we're then on to the final story, which is Vampire, yes. Starring Donald Sutherland, a very young Donald Sutherland, but I would say that as soon as he gets into that train carriage and says, sorry, to Christopher Lee, and then Christopher Lee kind of shuts him down with an icy stare, you can tell instantly that Sutherland is a movie star.
Yes. He's playing this sort of like gawky, it's like the awkward character. Then when he gets in the train carriage, he sort of falls onto the seat and he's sort of like this big lunk. Yeah, it's Donald Sutherland. Because he lived in England in those days and was doing things like The Saint and The Avengers and that sort of thing. And I'll never forget, there's an episode of The Avengers that's got Donald Sutherland, Charlotte Rampling and Brian Blessed.
That episode's called The Superlative.
Yes, I just couldn't believe when I first watched that at the age of, I don't know, 13, 14.
I've never seen it since I was about 15. I just remember that episode being amazing and just going,
mainly
what?
Just because of the cast.
Yeah,
I couldn't believe that these people were... And Charlotte Rampling, of course, is in a later Amicus film, so...
She is, and she's just been nominated for an Oscar.
Yes.
You know, that's the amazing reach that these films still have. Yeah, and in Vampire, Donald Sutherland plays an American doctor who's moved back to America with his French wife.
Jennifer Jane.
And it's obviously not America. Again, it's Shepperton Studios, and it's all indoors. He's one of the only two doctors in this small town, the other one being played by a great actor called Max Adrian.
Yes.
I always mention Halliwell's Film Guide. I remember the review of this in Halliwell's Film Guide. I haven't been able to check it because I've just moved house and all my books are in a box somewhere. But I remember it saying that something like, I think it was 2 stars, and it said something like, apart from a couple of naive stories, this is a fun little chocolate box thing. And Halliwell had a little quirk, which was that anybody involved in the film, whether on the production or the acting side, whose he felt they made a particular contribution to making the film as good as it is, they'd get their name italicised. And I remember that the italicised names in this cast were Peter Cushing, Christopher Lee, Max Adrian.
Not Christopher Lee.
Oh, not Christopher Lee.
It's Peter Cushing, Ursula Howells.
Oh, is it? Adrian. Oh, yeah. And I think that's right.
I think that's right.
Yeah.
Well, I would book Christopher Lee. I think Christopher Lee is good. I think Michael Gough is good.
Yeah. No, but they're very good, but it's the particular contributions. And I always like that. You know, yeah. I remember that Halliwell underrated Zulu, as far as I'm concerned.
Yes.
But he did highlight Michael Caine for being the one who pushed it beyond. But, yeah, Max Adrian gives a very arch, interesting performance.
Yes, it's
Dr.
quite an
Blake.
Eccentric performance. Yeah, he's not sending it up, but there's a certain sort of, like, humour to it, I think. He's sort of, I think...
Yes, and there is a moment of him looking into the camera as well. You know, there's that kind of, again, that slightly on the edge, well, this is all fun, but it's good fun.
Well, I've read that he really enjoyed making that film,
all right.
Max Adrian. And there's that sense to it. It's just an actor enjoying himself. But yeah, he's playing it straight, but there's a sense of slightly relishing it. And sort of like
he had a great face, and it's just good cinema to just see him on the screen. His eyes and his hawk-like nose, you know.
He's got a great voice as well.
Yeah. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know what kind of accent he was doing, but yeah.
That did actually sound quite like him. He's got that sort of kind of very nasal sort of voice, hasn't he? Sort of
like. Yeah. Because obviously in this film we are in America. We certainly are.
Well, it's set in New England, and they always used to set films. If a film was made in Britain, they set it in New England, so the accents don't sound... Because New England can sound a bit English in a way. So they
yeah, it's kind of Fraser.
Well, it is obviously in a studio. It's obviously a Shepperton Studios. It doesn't seem remotely American. If they didn't have American accents, you wouldn't know it's supposed to be in America.
But at the same time, I do like something of the atmosphere of it. And it reminds me a bit of an earlier film that Milton Subotsky produced called The City of the Dead, which again was set in New England, but filmed in London, and has Christopher Lee doing a really good American accent and a bunch of American actors and a singer called Dennis Lotis.
Dennis Lotis, yes.
And that's a really atmospheric little kind of black magic movie. So, yeah, and basically the plot of Vampire, which is very simple and we can't talk about it too much, but Donald Sutherland begins to suspect that his wife it might be a vampire. And that's about it, really.
There's a twist which is a great twist when you watch it. It's very neat, and you think, oh, that's... But if you think about it, the twist makes no sense.
No, I know what you mean.
But we can't say any more.
But it's still quite effective. Jennifer Jayne is really interesting, and she later became a screenwriter under the name Jay Fairbank and wrote a movie that we'll talk about in a bit that was also an anthology film directed by Freddie Francis called Tales of the Witness Madness.
Ooh.
And then we go back to the train carriage, and we have the proper twist ending of the linking story. And one of the things I like about an anthology movie like this is that you kind of have like five or six twist endings, twist on twist on twist, and that contributes to the film staying in your memory. I think often these movies can't, the overall twist in these movies is often the same thing.
Yes,
but And here is no exception. However, it's just very beautifully filmed. It's, and the music and the way that the reveals are done is just lovely, and stays with me. So I think we're near the end of our discussion of Dr. Terror's House of Horrors, although in a moment I would like to have a quick chat about a couple of the films which followed it. But Howard, is there anything else you'd like to say about this particular movie?
No, it's a favourite film of mine. I watch it. I actually watch it all the time. It's a weird thing. I actually find it very comforting.
Mm.
Now, a horror film is not supposed to be comforting. It's not supposed to be reassuring. But I watch it because I watched it as a kid, and because I like so many of the people in it, like Peter Cushing and Roy Castle and all these sort of people. And because it is kind of, it's scary, but it's not horrific. It's not particularly graphic. It's not gruesome. It's charming.
Anyway,
it's very much of its time. It's very 60s, and it's very sort of slightly gaudy and everything. But it is, it's trying so hard to be entertaining. Milton Subotsky is making a film just to entertain horror film fans, so he's putting everything in it. And so it has a real charm because of that. It's sort of like, you know, making a film for people like us, for people who like horror films. If you're a kid, it's the most wonderful thing, having vampires and werewolves and everything in the same film. And it's just, it's a favourite film of mine, and I can watch it over and over again, and indeed have done.
I think, as somebody said on another podcast, possibly the Amicus podcast, which is one of the best named podcasts I've discovered, it's like the ideal my first horror movie thing. You can show it to your kids, probably, you know, as long as they're older than about six. there's nothing too strong in it.
No, it's not gruesome, it's not graphic, it's just very charming.
But it's an appetizer. And it's it gets you attuned to that kind of atmosphere and those kind of thrills, really. So great. So let's just have a listen to Elisabeth Lutyens' final cue from the movie. This was the first of many horror anthology films, or portmanteaus, I believe is the word, that Amicus produced. And one of those, The House That Drank Blood in 1970, features again both Cushing and Lee, so we will discuss that in detail in another podcast. But, you know, there's about seven or eight of these films, so I don't think we should discuss them all now, but I do think maybe we should just discuss a couple of films that feel distinctly spun off from Dr. Terrors. The first one is the very following anthology film from Amicus, again directed by Freddie Francis in 1967, I think. It's called Torture Garden. And even as our old friend James Bernard on the music for two of the segments, no Elisabeth Lutyens, sadly. And no Christopher Lee, but it does have Peter Cushing again, and it has four stories linked by a funfair kind of House of Horrors character called Dr. Diablo, played by Burgess Meredith.
Burgess Meredith, the Penguin.
Yeah, and there's, again, like you said before, there's a more international feel to this one. Jack Palance is also...
This has got genuine Hollywood stars in it. This has got Jack Palance and Burgess Meredith, as well as Peter Cushing and a lot of very distinguished British character actors. And an actress called Beverly Adams, who did this film and disappeared without trace. And if you see her performance in the film, you'll understand why.
Right.
Bless her. Yeah, and it is set at a fun fair, so it's kind of the same. It looks the same. It's got the same feel. It's got the same texture. It's got that 60s kind of colour to it, and that sort of slightly lurid quality to it.
Yeah, I think some of the stories are good. Some of them are silly. The one with the evil piano.
Killer piano is. To be fair, it is really well done.
Mm.
It's actually quite well directed. Again, Ursula Howes is in that, giving a very good performance. They all give very good performances. It's done as well as it could possibly be done. It's just a film about a killer piano. A piano possessed by an evil spirit or something that kills people, and you can't get over that. However well it's done, you can't get over the fact that it's about a killer piano.
No, but the whole film does look nice. And although I think overall its linking story isn't as atmospheric in setting as Dr. Sarah's, because like a funfair thing just isn't as claustrophobic or transporting, literally, as a train carriage is, I think, for telling those kind of spooky stories. It works. And I think one of the stories, the one with Jack Palance and Peter Cushing, which is The Man Who Collected Poe, is probably the best story out of the two films in general. I just think
yes.
It's very strong.
Mm.
And in fact, that particular story made a strong impression on Martin Scorsese, for instance, which is why 20-odd years later he hired Freddie Francis to shoot Photograph, his remake of Cape Fear, because he wanted that kind of horror heritage present in that particularly scary movie. And he did mention to Freddie Francis, yeah, The Man Who Collected Poe was brilliant. I've never forgotten you because of that. And another film which we've already mentioned, but should talk a little more about, is Tales That Witness Madness, which was the only horror anthology-type movie made in the 60s and 70s that Milton Subotsky had nothing to do with. It's actually made by World Productions or something. But you'd think it was a close cousin to Dr. Sarah, because it's directed by Freddie Francis, and it's also written under the name Jay Fairbank by the actress from Vampire, Jennifer Jane. It's a bit of a weird film, though, and I remember reading an interview with Jennifer Jane where she said that it wasn't really intended as a horror film. They just had to make it more horrific because that was the market that the production company or the distributor wanted to push it towards. So you end up with this movie. It's linked by a clinic run by a psychiatrist played by Donald Pleasance in what feels like a wonderful kind of pre-Halloween dry run, and he's working with four particular patients, and each one of them has a story associated with them, which we then go into the story supposed to be the pathology behind their madness. And they're quite quirky, odd stories. And
very quirky.
They've all got something a bit horrific in them, but they're not that horrific, and really it does feel like it was intended as a black comedy or something, but they just kind of pushed it in the horror direction. Yeah, the story with Michael Jayston is possibly the most memorable one, maybe not for the best reason. What was that you said before about that?
Well,
story?
I just said, if you were married to Joan Collins, would you dump Joan Collins for a tree?
That is the plot of
that's
story.
The plot. I'm still undecided.
Yeah, I think it's a tough one. There's also the evil penny farthing story. There's a time-travelling penny farthing which controls people, as in, if you look at this penny farthing in an antique shop, it possesses you to get on it and start peddling, which then sends you back in time, which means that actors have to do this amazing thing where they act being dragged towards a penny farthing against their will by an invisible force, and then act peddling really fast against their will. Certainly an acting test which should be included on some level in RADA, I think. And the linking story has the clinic that Donald Pleasance is running being visited by Jack Hawkins. Mm. Jack Hawkins, of course, great British movie star of the 40s and 50s. kind of on the skids by this point. He lost his voice a few years before, I believe.
Yes.
Was it throat cancer?
It was throat cancer.
And
so he had to do fairly small roles, supporting roles. And he was dubbed by Charles Grey, usually, or by other actors.
Yes, yeah, certainly in the movie of Kidnapped, he's dubbed by Charles Grey. You can tell it a mile off.
Theatre of Blood, he's dubbed by Charles Grey.
Right, okay. And I don't know if he had no voice at all, or if it was, you know, in real life, or whether he could, like, speak in a whisper or something. But there's something about his performance in this film particularly where he looks like someone who has no voice, and in order to be make sure that the other person in the scene with him understands him, he does a really big kind of mimed thing, which then Charles Grey dubbing it has to match.
Mm.
So Charles Grey ends up saying things like, "All four subjects completed at last." And it's just like, it just seems to be shouting in Donald Pleasance's face.
He could speak with great difficulty.
Right.
So if you saw him, you could tell he was speaking with difficulty. So he had to sort of mime it. Then it looked like he was speaking properly.
Right, okay.
So he could speak. I also want to say that one of the stories has, and I only saw this film a very long time ago, so I don't remember that well. I think there's a story, a black magic story with Kim Novak.
It's got Kim Novak and Mary Tam, and it's quite good, actually.
But
I like that
part, the Kim Novak part, was originally offered to no less than Rita Hayworth.
Okay.
One of the great stars and absolutely gorgeous actress. And I'm glad you didn't do it, because it's a rubbish film. And it would have been demeaning for her, because I'm a great fan of Rita Hayworth, and I wouldn't want to see her doing something like that.
No, fair enough. Although it is the only other film apart from Vertigo that I've ever seen Kim Novak in. So I'm just glad to see her.
Yes. No, she's perfectly fine. Have you never seen the TV movie Satan's Triangle?
No.
She's in that. Oh, you should watch that.
Okay.
Now there's a twist.
That's one to mention. Mm. All right. And there are several other Amicus films, which I think we'll, when we do The House of the Red Blood, we'll discuss the 70s ones, I think. Unless you want to talk a little bit about From Beyond the Grave now. I just wanted to mention that because I know that you are particularly fond of From Beyond the Grave. And I do see it as, in a way, the spiritual direct sequel to Dr. Terror, because it is the only one, the only other one of all the Amicus films in which the storyteller, the linking character, is played by Peter Cushing.
Yes.
He's really good in that one as well.
I think From Beyond the Grave is the only film where all the stories are successful. All the stories work. There's not one dove story. Even in something like Tales from the Crypt, which I really like, there is one not very good story. So, and there's always, that's the thing about the Amicus films, there is this inconsistency. There's always like one that lets it down. And you have to sort of like sit through that to get to
the... But at the same time, that's the appeal of it. I mean, you know, as my sister Maureen, who introduced me to all this stuff in the first place, you know, she loves these movies. Because you can sit down and watch them and you know that there's going to be one bit of it that's good at least, you know. Whereas you can't guarantee that with a single story movie.
No, yes.
So, and all of them do have one or two really good stories in them.
They do. If you could put all the good stories together, you'd have one hell of a film. But I have to say, of all of them, I think Dr. Terror's House of Horrors is my favourite.
Oh, okay.
Yes, it is. It's the one. It's not the best one. I don't think anybody would say it's the best one, but it's the one I find most enjoyable. So, yeah, watch it. If it's on Horror Channel, then you should watch it, because it's great.
What a lovely note to end this bit of the podcast on. So, onwards.
James Bernard Jukebox.
And here's the bit of the podcast where we celebrate the music of classic horror films. And the movie we've just been discussing, Tales That Witness Madness, is not a classic horror film, but it does have a rather good score by a German jazz composer called Bernard Ebbinghaus. I remember a film that was really obscure that I came across on Channel 4 late one night when I was about 16, that me and my friend Andy, we were at college together at the time, we both accidentally watched it and were really impressed by it and were talking about how unusually gritty it was. And it's a sci-fi movie directed by Alan Bridges called Invasion.
Yes, I know Invasion. That's Edward Judd, isn't it?
It's Edward Judd and Barry Ingham and Yoko Tani.
Yoko Tani.
Playing a non-Chinese alien. From a race of non-Chinese aliens, or rather they are played by Chinese actors, and that's just the way it is because it's low budget. We're not doing anything else to make them look alien. They're Chinese, folks. That's alien enough for us. Maybe that is a bit racist.
It was the time.
Yeah. Anyway, let's change the record. But no, I really like the score. It had this kind of distinctive heartbeat-like doom, 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 doom score by Bernard Ebbinghaus. And then when I watched Tales That Witness Madness, I was delighted to say that it was him again. It's the same production company, World. Yeah, it has. It's really funky and has an unusual vibe to it, and does kind of hint at the fact that maybe this wasn't meant to be a horror movie. It sounds a bit more wacky and a bit more intriguing than that, and the film ultimately is. But I think it's rather good. So let's have a listen to it. Bag of Death, which this time we have audio to support the fact that it's the Bag of Death. That's production values, folks. So this is the part of the show where we have a bag filled with the names of various British horror movies that both I and Howard have seen over the years, but maybe not so recently, maybe fairly recently. And Howard will pick one at random.
I will pick one at random.
We hope that it's good so that we can talk about it.
As in the FA Cup, I will give it a good mixed round. You can hear that. And I'll pick one from the bottom there. I think I'm picking up something. Right, and it's Lust for a Vampire.
Oh, my heavens.
Lust for a Vampire.
Another one which I think will be seen on the Horror Channel sometime soon. Well, strange love, Howard. Strange love.
It was made in about 1970 when Hammer was sort of, I think, slightly faltering a little bit. Mm. Some of the films they were making at the time, like Horror of Frankenstein, were not so great. And they'd done so many Frankenstein films, so many Dracula films by that stage that they were sort of, I think, becoming a little bit repeating themselves and perhaps a little bit stale. And although they made some great films at that time, like Blood from the Mummy's Tomb and stuff like that, and Dr. Jekyll and Sister Hyde, some of them were not so.
They were a little later.
They were a little bit later. This one is sort of like, and it's weird because it's directed by Jimmy Sangster, who wrote all the classic early Hammer films, Curse of Frankenstein, Dracula the Mummy. But somehow it's just not very. It doesn't really do it for me.
Well, although Jimmy Sangster did direct some of the films, some of which might be good. I'm thinking in particular, is it Fear in the Night?
Fear in the Night. Yes.
I think that's quite respectable. I've never seen it. Horror of Frankenstein, though, the spoof remake of Frankenstein, which we talked about last time, it's not supposed to be very good.
It's not very good.
But although he wrote that, he did not write Lust for a Vampire, but I get the impression that there's just not a lot of interest in what's going on from the director. We should explain that because Hammer's horror output was faltering a little bit, we're moving into the era now where their most successful films, possibly the most successful British films going for a couple of years, were things like the On the Buses films,
yes,
which were Hammer productions. The horror market was petering out a little bit, and Hammer were looking for ways to reinvigorate it. One of the things they tried was to bring in new stars, a new generation of horror stars. So we had people like Ralph Bates, who was introduced as the new Baron Frankenstein in the horror of Frankenstein and is also the star of this film. But they didn't really take off, although I think Ralph Bates is rather good.
He is good. Peter Cushing was intended to play that part.
In which one? In
this? For a Vampire.
Oh, okay.
Because I remember seeing there's a picture of him in the costume.
Right.
The pince nez glasses that Ralph Bates wears. So I think he was the first choice. He couldn't do it for whatever reason. Maybe this was when his wife was ill, so he couldn't do it. So Ralph Bates took over. Yeah, it's sort of... I just don't...
Well, the weird thing is that although they were setting him up as a new young star, he's playing the Cushing role in this, the elderly Cushing role. He's the kind of old fuddy-duddy guy in it, isn't he? Another thing they tried to do was engage new producers, and there were two independent producers with amazing names. In fact, there were three guys with amazing names in this production. The producers are called Harry Fine and Michael Style. Mm. How the hell that happened? And they worked with a screenwriter with an even more amazing name called Tudor Gates.
Tudor Gates, yes.
Who, for a long time, I think, was like president of the Writers Guild of Great Britain or something. And they came to Hammer with the idea of adapting Sheridan Le Fanu's Carmilla, which was one of the early great pieces of vampire literature, you know, pre-Dracula, and has lesbian overtones to it, which they brought out rather vividly in the first film that they made, which was 1969-70s, The Vampire Lovers, directed by Roy Ward Baker, which has Cushing and Douglas Wilmer, but most importantly has Ingrid Pitt as Carmilla.
And George Cole.
And George Cole. And that was very successful, relatively speaking, and did have these kind of explicit lesbian sex scenes in it and nudity and things, Madeline Smith taking her clothes off and stuff. So Hammer kind of went, whoa, that works, more of that, please. So they engaged Fine and Style to make Lust for a Vampire, which was a sequel, essentially, to The Vampire Lovers. Jimmy Sangster came on board to direct it, but obviously didn't have a very good time doing it and didn't seem very interested in it. The film itself is one of Hammer's great disasters, I think. There are things in it. Well, me and my friend Brendan went through a proper Hammer... I mean, I've always been in a Hammer phase. I'm never out of a Hammer phase. He'd come round to my house for coffee fairly regularly. We were school friends and we remained mates. We got to a phase where we'd always watch Hammer films and he'd say, can we watch something with Christopher Lee in? Unfortunately, one week I didn't have Christopher Lee. I just had Lust for a Vampire. And I just remember some of the production values being so rubbish that they really inspired us. They're just so funny. And in fact, there's a moment in the film where a character falls to his death down a well. I don't know if you remember this.
Yes, I do.
And it's funny that we were just talking on The Curse of Frankenstein last time about how well the death of Professor Waldman was achieved with a stuntman actually throwing himself through a balustrade and hitting the ground. Well, they didn't do that on this one. They just threw a dummy down a well and then dubbed a scream onto it. And the wonderful thing about the dummy is, A, it's obviously a dummy. It doesn't move or react in any way at all. And halfway down the well, it smashes into the side of the well head first. You know, and like, it doesn't break in half. But, you know, it's like, it's clearly a killing blow. If you smash your head into anything like that, you're dead. But instead of cutting the scream off when it smashes, they had the scream do a reaction. So it's kind of like, ah, yeah! And that's just one of my favourite dub screams ever, and I've been asked to recreate that on various things more than once, and recently did it on an animated project, which I hope will come out soon, and I hope sounds half as wonderful as the one on Lust for a Vampire. Another thing we should say is that the character of Carmilla was killed at the end of The Vampire Lovers, but she's resurrected, being a vampire. She's resurrected in Lust for a Vampire, and there are kind of cultish characters who help to resurrect her and then do her bidding. And one of them is played by Mike Raven, who I believe was another radio DJ. There's themes in this episode which are coming up, which I'm rather pleased with. He was like a radio... not Radio 1. I'm not sure if there was Radio 1 at the time.
I don't know too much about him. I've sort of tried to find out about him. He was in a few horror films at that stage, mainly because he had like a very sinister-looking goatee beard.
Yeah.
He was dubbed a couple of times in some of the films.
Dubbed in this one. Basically, he wasn't an actor. He couldn't act. He did have a nice beard, and that's it. He's in I, Monster, which is a Christopher Lee piece. Crushing film, so we'll talk about that later on. But in this one, he plays like the big villain. But he just had... He had nothing. He had no presence. They obviously knew that. Jimmy Sangster obviously knew that. So they dubbed him with Valentine Dial, who is one of the best voices that any human being can ever have. And I can't do it, because nobody can. Hmm. And they even edited in close-ups of his eyes, extreme close-ups of his eyes, so that you wouldn't have to look at his expressionless face. And they're not even his eyes. They're Christopher Lee's eyes from one of the later Dracula films. So, you know, they obviously knew that they were on hiding to nothing with this. There was also a problem that Ingrid Pitt, who'd originally played Carmilla, wasn't coming back. I don't know why. So they hired a Swedish actress called Jutta Stensgaard, who has a very interesting chin.
Yes. Is this the film where Jutta Stensgaard portrays somebody having an orgasm by crossing her eyes?
Yes.
This is that film, yes.
That's what I mean when I say strange love, because we have in that sex
that's
scene,
the song,
which is with Ralph Bates, has a terrible early 70s pop song played over it called Strange Love. And you kind of imagine that the moment when he saw that in the edit suite was the moment when Jimmy Sangster went, I've had enough of this, because he did walk off the production, I think.
I don't know. I just watched it not that long ago, and I just thought this film has no atmosphere. The cast is unengaging. Nobody's really bothered about it. The story just doesn't seem to go anywhere. The production values are not high. It's just so bland. It's just so kind of... There's nothing to it. There's no substance to this film at all.
Considering that we go on about the music quite a lot in this podcast, there's not even a good musical score. The score is by a guy called Harry Robinson. And again, it's really bland. And he can be really good, but it just isn't. There's just nothing there.
Everything is bland. Everything is bland about it.
Oh, no.
It's just like nobody's bothered. It's just like they're all going through the motions. They've got to make this film, so they're doing it. But there's no... The energy and the passion that was in the early Hammer films just isn't there at all. It's just... Well, it's just the sex. It's all about the sex. They realise that sex sells at that time.
The irony, though, was that although sex sells in Britain, in America, the Hammer films were aimed at children. They were considered like childish fantasies. So they would cut out the extreme bits and market them at kids. So obviously they had to cut out all the sex and all the nudity and rendered the films incomprehensible by this point because they were all sex and nudity. It was all there was.
Yeah.
So Hammer was just cutting itself out of a whole market by doing that, really. This is the peril of the Bag of Death. We never know what's going to come out of the Bag of Death. And it might not be something very good and we might not be able to be very positive about it. What I will say, to reverse that tone slightly, is that you'd come out of that movie never wanting to watch another film produced by Harry Fine and Michael Stiehle and written by Tudor Gates, ever. But they did do a third Karnstein movie, which is a prequel to the other two, called Twins of Evil, just a year later, or 2 years later. Basically, the whole creative team, Fine, Stiehle and Harry Robinson and Tudor Gates, they're all back, but it's got Peter Cushing and a good director, John Hoff, and it's absolutely cracking. I love that one. And I love the theme music, and I hope we'll play that in James Bernard's jukebox at some point. So don't watch Lust for a Vampire, even if it's on the horror channel. Wait for Twins of Evil.
Lust for a Vampire is interesting in what it says about Hammer at the time. Kind of like the way Hammer was changing and what kind of audience it was trying to appeal to and sort of having a bit of an identity crisis at that time. Because a lot of Night of the Living Dead had come out at that stage and Witchfinder General had come out. So does Hammer keep on doing what it's always done, or does it try to change to adapt to a new audience which wants more sex and which wants more violence? I think it's an interesting film because it's sort of, it doesn't quite know what it wants to be. Hammer doesn't quite know what it wants to be at that stage, I think.
Yes, and they did become more confident and they got a bit more...
But there's a lot of very good Hammer films made after that.
Yes. It's a transitional point.
It's when they're trying to do a traditional vampire, Hammer vampire movie, but doing it in a new way and it doesn't work. Yeah. If you want to do something in a new way, you have to have a new idea, like Blood from the Mummy's Tomb. It's a completely different take on the mummy, because it doesn't have a mummy in it. And it works. Lust for a Vampire is caught between being a traditional Hammer vampire film and trying to be something different. But also, I just say thought it was very, the script is just very banal and it's just not a very good film anyway.
Mm. Well, alas. But yes, but Twins of Evil is very good.
The Bag of Death.
Well, folks, that brings us to the end of the second episode of the Lee Cushing Podcast. We'll just wrap up a few things before we finish. And one of them is our beloved horror channel, Freeview Channel 70, if we haven't mentioned it already. is always good for some classic British horror movies. We've got a few examples coming up this month. Any in particular that you'd like to mention, Howard?
Yes, a film I'm quite fond of called Mask of the Red Death, with Vincent Price and Hazel Court, which is one of Roger Corman's Edgar Allan Poe adaptions, one of the best ones, I think. It's a very strange film because it's very theatrical. It's not a realistic film at all. It's done in a very theatrical way, and it's about Vincent Price plays his count, who is in his castle, and there's a terrible plague ravaging the countryside, but he thinks he's safe inside his castle, only he isn't. I think it's called Prospero, Prince Prospero, in it, which is... He's great. And there's a wonderful bit where he kills Paul Whitson Jones by firing a crossbow into Paul Whitson Jones's chest.
Okay.
I remember that. And Nigel Green's in it, and lots of good actors. And it's a very interesting film, the way it's done. Because he was making those films at the same time as Hammer was making theirs, but they're very different. They're much... Mark Gatiss says they're much... more queasy films, more unsettling films. I think they are.
There's a psychological aspect to them.
There's a psychological aspect, there's a dreamlike atmosphere to a lot of them, especially to this one. There's a lot of like dancing and such like. And
I think because they're inspired by Poe, that there's a sense of madness and illusory things going on, and claustrophobia created by being stuck in castles and things. The Mask of the Red Death was Corman's first production in England. They actually filmed it in England, and it was photographed by the great Nicholas Roeg, who later directed some epic horror films of his own, Don't Look Now and The Witches, but all of his films could be described as horrific in some way, masterpieces like Bad Timing and Walkabout, which all deal with reality and sexuality and time in strange, provocative ways. He's a great filmmaker. The Man Who Fell to Earth as well. But before he was a director, he was a great cinematographer, also worked on Lawrence of Arabia and things like that. And yeah, obviously he took the low budget of The Mask of the Red Death and kind of directed it into creating this kind of dreamlike, unreal space. I haven't actually seen all the film, but I've seen enough of it to get an impression of that kind of quality.
It does have a strange, eerie, just dreamlike, yes, quality to it. And Vincent Price is at his best, and he's always worth watching. He's great. So, yeah, watch that one. And also, I've noticed that Dino Croc versus Super Gator is on. It might have gone already.
Classic film.
I think if you're looking for a good time, then I'd certainly watch that one.
And on that note, I always like to thank someone who's inspired me on the path of appreciating these films before we end our podcast. And I'd just like to make mention of an individual who's sadly no longer with us called Jerry Kubrow, who was one of my teachers at university when I did film studies with production at Sheffield Hallam. He was in charge of teaching the Hammer Unit, possibly the only Hammer Unit at any university in the country. Shortly after we finished, although he was still there, the Hammer Unit was discontinued. Someone obviously felt it was no longer too relevant. But certainly I loved it, and his enthusiasm for it was clear to see, even though he was fond of the drink, Jerry, and he wasn't always the most coherent individual. There was a wonderful moment where we were talking about the Quatermass experiment, and we discussed the tendency of Hammer in its early days to, like a lot of small British companies, bring in international actors, American actors, to kind of headline their productions and make them a bit bigger, and therefore they brought in Brian Donlevy. And Jerry said to me, in the class discussion, Jerry said to me, "Ah, but the thing about Brian Donlevy, he wasn't American, was he?" And I said, "No, Jerry, he was Irish, actually." And Jerry said, "Oh, you knew that? How did you know that?" And I said, "You told me, Jerry, 2 weeks ago." But he was absolutely lovable. On the last day of uni, he took a lot of us out to the pub and bought a round of drinks, God bless him, which seemed rather characteristic of him. Sadly, I went back to Sheffield a few years later and saw him sitting outside the showroom cinema chatting to somebody. And I thought about going up to him, but thought, he probably won't remember me. And I'm really sad that I didn't go up to him, because the next thing I knew, a couple of years later, I'd heard he died. But certainly he's someone I had very fond memories of, and he and I had many good discussions. He lent me his video of Quatermass 2, which was very rare at the time, the BBC version of Quatermass 2, and I lent him my video of Frightmare, which he'd never seen before.
I haven't seen it either.
Oh, well, I hope you'll soon be able to rectify that. I'll dig it out of my collection. So yeah, so this one's for you, Jerry. Nice work, fella. Hope you're having a high old time somewhere, wherever you are. And is there anyone in particular you'd like to pay tribute to, Howard?
I just want to pay tribute to my mum and dad for letting me watch all these films when I was 10 years old. Irresponsible, yes, letting me stay up late, but I'm so glad they did. So thanks, guys.
That's what parents should be sometimes, irresponsible. We love them all the more for it. So that's it for this month, the Lee Cushing Podcast, another episode. We'll be back in 1 month, so please keep your eyes on noisybark.com. As for the film we'll be discussing next time, well, there are another 22 films to choose from, so let's keep it a surprise for now. Thanks very much, folks. It's been great fun for us. Really hope you've enjoyed it too, and speak to you again soon.
Yes, thank you very much, and goodbye.
You have been listening to the Lee Cushing Podcast, written and presented by Daniel Thackeray and myself, Howard Whittock. Other episodes can be found at noisybark.com or on iTunes. If you enjoyed the episode, please leave us a review. It was produced and edited by Daniel Thackeray for Ambidextrous Solutions Limited, with special thanks to Richard O'Neill of noisybark.com. Ambidextrous Solutions Limited is not affiliated with Hammer, Exclusive, Amicus, Tygon British, Tyburn, the UK Horror Channel, or any other copyright holders of the films excerpted or discussed in this podcast, which is produced for entertainment, criticism, and education.
Baba Black Sheep, have you any wool? Yes, sir, 3 bags full.
In the spirit of fair dealing as defined in British law and fair use as defined in US law, and no copyright infringement is intended. The Lee Cushing Podcast is copyright 2016, and no part of it may be reproduced without written permission from Ambidextrous Solutions Limited. Sarah Nichols became Phoebe Nichols.
Say that again, because my yelp of surprise might have cut you off. So.
And the actress who plays that child in Dr. House, Sarah Nichols, grew up to be a very distinguished actress who does a lot of TV these days, called Phoebe Nichols.
No way.